great to be with you. I want to also say a special welcome to our first-time guest. My name is Pastor Eric. I'd love to meet you. And also to all those engaged with us online, we're glad that you are with us as well. So if you have your scriptures, I want to encourage you to grab your scriptures, however you do that, and let's turn together to the book of Acts in the New Testament. We're going to begin a series, as Pastor Stephen just shared, through the book of Acts, and we're going to begin at chapter 1. And so go ahead and get your scriptures and turn there with me. And as you're turning there, I've been thinking about social media and the platforms that we have, like Facebook and Instagram. I know many of us are on those, and those platforms tend to show mostly our ups. You know, that great picture of that great meal that we had with our spouse, you know, we'll post or share that. Maybe that picture of the first day of school, kids and new shoes, new clothes, we'll post that. We tend to post mostly our ups. Rarely do we post our downs. Like, I never posted a picture of the inside of our minivan. You know, that's not for you to see. We actually had to buy a new car because it was so bad inside. But nobody shows that, right? We tend to show our ups and celebrate our ups, but not our downs. And this reminds me of the book of Acts. Many of us are familiar with the book of Acts. We're familiar with the ups of Acts chapter 2, when the Holy Spirit comes at Pentecost, or when Saul meets Jesus on his way to Damascus, or when these followers of Jesus for the very first time are called Christians. I mean, we're familiar with the ups in the book of Acts. Most of us aren't familiar with the downs in the book of Acts. And you may be surprised, there's a lot of them. And so just like our lives, the book of Acts is filled with ups and downs. And as we study the book of Acts over the next several months, we're going to see that even though through the ups and downs, God still used the apostles and the early church. They were empowered by the Holy Spirit, and they were emboldened by Jesus' promise. And I want us to look at that together. Acts chapter 1, we're going to actually go and read beginning at verse 6. So I encourage you, as I read, for you to follow along as well. So when they had come together, this is the apostles with Jesus, they began asking him, saying, Lord, is it at this time that you are restoring the kingdom to Israel? But Jesus said to them, it is not for you to know the periods of time or appointed times which the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you shall be my witnesses, both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria, and as far as the remotest part of the earth. Now, to help set up the book of Acts, to help set up this teaching series, I want us to see what I've called the Acts of Acts. So hang with me just for a moment. First, I want to ask you, and please, this is a chance for you to participate, who is the author of the book of Acts? Luke, fantastic. Luke is the author of this great book, and he was likely writing this letter in the late 60s. Did you know this, though? That the Apostle Paul refers to Luke as the beloved physician. So he's a doctor. He was a medical doctor. So here's Luke, this medical doctor, but he's also like a historian, because he's written this book and another. And so he's using his talents, he's using his gifts, and he's using his skills to serve Paul and help meet Paul's physical needs. But also, he's serving us by giving us a quarter of the New Testament. I mean, imagine if Luke never existed. We wouldn't have the Gospel of Luke, and we wouldn't have the book of Acts. So I'm thankful for the doctor. I'm thankful for Luke. And how about some of you? You have been uniquely wired. You have certain skills. You have certain talents. And just as God used Luke, who was not one of the original 12, God wants to also use you. So maybe a question with your spouse, maybe a question with your connection group is, How can we use our talents to serve others and advance the message of Jesus Christ? And so Luke is the author. That's the A. And the C is conditions. Now, hang with me. More teaching this morning, but hang with me. And I'm going to say this. I'm going to say favorable conditions. Because during this time, the world power of the day was Rome. And Rome ruled the known world. And there was this part of this land that is called the Mediterranean Basin. And I want to show you a slide so you can see this. This is the Mediterranean Basin right there in the middle of the sea. And all the land that surrounds it was basically overseen by Rome. They were this centralized power. And it was called Pax Romana, the Peace of Rome. Because you had the centralized power, sound familiar? And they were promoting some peace and prosperity. See, Rome built roads. And so trade and commerce began kind of off the charts. People could travel and trade across different towns and states and countries now because of Rome and all the roads and byways that they built. So the transportation was off the charts. But not just transportation, talk. There was a common language. At this time, the common language was Greek. And so you could travel from city state to city state, town to town, village to village, and you most likely could find someone that could speak Greek. So you could trade or you could share stories. You could build relationships. And so there's this transportation. There's talk, common talk, but there's also tolerance. With Rome taking over the known world, some of the small religions began to kind of fade away and new religions began to rise. They were called the mystery religions. And because people were becoming more intelligent, they were starting to do away with superstitions and the gods that people believed in. And so there was this tolerance of people believing whatever they wanted to, as long as you would support Rome. And these are the conditions of the book of Acts. The conditions of the known world at this time. Now, why are these important? For two reasons. One is these conditions are similar to ours today. Think about it. There is a tolerance in our culture for all things. There is a way that we can communicate. I was in India right before COVID, and I'm amazed at the number of people there that speak English. There's a common language, just as there were during the book of Acts. And just as transportation was a way for people to connect and be unified and share thoughts and ideas, we have the internet that allows us to be connected with the world. And so the conditions that existed during the first century are the same conditions that we have today. And remember, it was in these conditions that the church was born and multiplied across the known world. And that's why these conditions are called favorable, because they were favorable for the spread of Christianity. And I want to believe today that they are favorable today for the message of Jesus to spread. These are the conditions that we find in the book of Acts. There's also the theme. A theme in the book of Acts. And if you go and look at Acts chapter 1, verse 1, Luke, as he's writing, this is kind of how we figure out who the author is. As he's writing, he begins to talk about his other book that he wrote, which was the Gospel of Luke. And in Acts chapter 1, verse 1, he's writing, he says, "In my former book, I wrote about all that Jesus did and said." And he's going to continue that, but this is what the book of Acts is about. He's going to take all that Jesus did and said, and here's what he's going to say. He says, "Now the book of Acts, the theme that runs the book of Acts, is all that Jesus will do and will teach through his disciples, through his apostles, through the church by the power of the Holy Spirit." And so that's the theme we see running through the book of Acts. And then one more. S, hang with me. S. This is the setting of this particular chapter, this particular part of the story. When you read Acts chapter 1, verses 3 and 4, it says that Jesus, after he rose from the dead, he spent about 40 days with his apostles, convincing them and showing them how he was truly alive. And it says in Acts chapter 1, he taught them two things. He taught them about the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven, and he taught them about the Holy Spirit. And this is where we pick up in Acts chapter 1, verse 6. And so this is what I call the Acts of the book of Acts. And so let us see in verse 6 now the curiosity of the apostles. In verse 6, it says, so when they had come together, referring to his 12, the original apostles, they began asking him. Now, how amazing would it be just to be able to just be with Jesus and ask him a question? Well, the disciples, the apostles, they were able to do this, and questions reveal much. And notice what question is. Lord, is it at this time you are restoring the kingdom to, what does your scripture say? Israel. Israel. See, they're still not quite in sync with Jesus. Jesus has been teaching them about the kingdom of heaven, about the kingdom of God, and what are they concerned about? The kingdom of Israel. They're still not quite there. They are nationalistic focused. So this is their curiosity that leads to this question. And Jesus, he's going to answer their question, but not necessarily with a yes or no. And in answering the apostles, Jesus is going to commission them. Look at verse 7. But he said to them, it is not for you to know the periods of time or the appointed times which the Father has set by his own authority. And so here Jesus speaks of the Father. And if you pay close attention in these just these few verses, there's a picture of the Trinity. God the Father here is mentioned, and it's mentioned that he is the one in control. He's the one in control. He's the sovereign Lord. And I think Jesus is wanting them to understand he is in charge of, he is sovereign over the periods of time, and he's appointed them. And I think we have to be careful to concern ourselves with what we can't control and instead concern ourselves with the one who is in control. If you're like me, I find myself often concerned about what I cannot control. And I need to turn that energy towards the one who is in control. Maybe this morning, maybe somebody engaged with us online, this is you. You're trying to control. But maybe instead of trying to control what you can't control, maybe the word for you this morning is to stop that and to be concerned with the one who is in control. Amen? Well, then Jesus is going to come to a statement that is super important. If you are an educator, maybe an English major, then you would say this is the thesis. But I know there's athletes and coaches in the room. You would refer to what we're about to see as kind of the bread and butter. And then I see some of you in the room, I'm sure some of you engage with us online, some of you are organizational leaders, business leaders, you would call this the mission statement. And that's what we're going to see in verse 8. And Jesus says, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses, both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and as far as the remotest part of the earth. This is the mission of the entire book of Acts. Now, I know some of you are familiar with this game. It's called Tetherball. And does anybody want to play? I'm sure you would, yes. So the way it works, for those who aren't familiar, you know, one person stands here and you hit the ball this way, and then there's another person on this side. And this person's over here, and he's hitting it the opposite way. And so what you're trying to do to win, you're trying to get the ball to come all the way around until it stops. For somebody that's short like me, this is not a very fun game to play. But if you play this game and if you notice, the ball, every single time, it comes back to the pole. Every time. Every time the ball comes back to the pole. It's because it's tethered. It's tethered to the pole. And when I think of Acts chapter 1, verse 8, I think about how all the stories in the book of Acts are tethered to that particular verse. If you were to take your Bible and you were to sit down and read through the book of Acts, start at chapter 1 all the way to the very end, you would always see how all the stories come back to Acts chapter 1, verse 8. This is the mission of the book. Everything comes back to this verse. Just as every time you hit this ball, it comes back to the pole. The ball is tethered to the pole, and the stories in the book of Acts are tethered to verse 8 in chapter 1. It's the mission of the book. But it's not just the mission. It's the movement of the book. Now, some of you have never seen this, and I want to share it with you. If we were to take Acts chapter 1, verse 8, and we were to kind of take this verse apart, and I want to show you, if we were to take it apart, you would read, and you would see it says, you'll receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses. And here's what I mean, Acts chapter 1, verse 8, is the movement of the book. Chapters 1 through chapter 7 are about Jesus' followers being witnesses in Jerusalem. And then when you get to Acts chapter 8, there's a moment, there's something that happens there. You'll see how that movement, how the witnesses are pushed to Judea and to Samaria. And then in Acts chapter 13, there's another special moment, and you'll see how from there, Jesus' disciples began to go to the ends of the earth. So not only is Acts chapter 1, verse 8, the mission of the book, it is the movement of the book. It's a movement of the book. Just if you were to take a rock and to throw it into a body of water, there would be a ripple effect. There would be these concentric circles that would go outward, that would be directed outward. That's the movement of the book of Acts. It's directed outward. This is why your church, we as a congregation, give away 23 cents to every dollar out of here to support our global, to support our national and our local ministry partners, because we believe in this movement as a leadership and as a body of believers. And so 23 cents of every dollar that is given goes out. We are to be an outward focused people. And so Acts chapter 1, I can't stress this enough, it's the mission and the movement of the book. The mission and the movement. And I want to take the rest of our time to look at two things, one involving the Holy Spirit. And if you'll look at verse 8, you'll see that it's the Holy Spirit that gives the power. It's the Holy Spirit that gives the power. And I know there's lots of confusion about the Holy Spirit. There's lots of confusion. And so I want us to look at what Jesus says about the Holy Spirit. In John chapter 16, Jesus is teaching his disciples. Jesus is about to go to the cross. And so he's sitting with them, and he's going to tell them about the Holy Spirit. Here's what I want you to see about the Holy Spirit. In John chapter 16, verses 12 through 14, Jesus says, I have many more things to say to you, but you cannot bear them at the present time. But when the Spirit of truth comes. Notice what the Spirit will do. He will guide you into all truth, for he will not speak on his own, but whatever he hears, he will speak, and he will disclose to you what is to come. And here's what I want us all to see. He, the Holy Spirit, will glorify me, Jesus says. The Holy Spirit's job, the Holy Spirit's function is to exalt, is to magnify, is to make much of Jesus. And he empowers us so that we as men and women can exalt and glorify and magnify Jesus Christ. We cannot do that on our own. And Jesus says, here's the Holy Spirit, and he has come to exalt me. And so the Holy Spirit gives us this power, and he gives the disciples this power, and so they can walk forward. They can move forward with this mission with courage because they have this power. Warren Wiersbe says this about this particular passage and about the Holy Spirit in his commentary on Acts chapter 1. He says this, ordinary people were able to do extraordinary things because the Spirit of God was at work in their lives. And I like what he says here. The ministry of the Holy Spirit is not a luxury. It is an absolute necessity. We need the Holy Spirit and the power that he gives us so that we today, as the apostles did 2,000 years ago, can walk in courage. Can walk in courage. And that's the Holy Spirit. And then notice what Jesus says. And you shall be my witnesses. Over 20 times in this book, the word witnesses is used. You will be my witnesses. I don't know if you've ever been in a courtroom, hopefully not, unless you were on a jury, but I have, and I was sitting in the gallery. And if those of you don't know, the gallery is where the spectators sit. And all the spectators are doing is just that. They're just watching. But it's the witnesses who are on the witness stand that are speaking about what they have seen and heard. They're confirming the truth. And a witness in this context is someone that's willing to do that at all cost. And when I think about the witness and I think about the spectator, I think about the church. I think there are those in the church that are spectators. And I think there are those in the church that are witnesses. And I read this week that over 60% of adults experience some level of boredom. They're just bored. We have more entertainment than we possibly can imagine. We have more places that we can travel than we've ever been able to travel before. But still, over 60% of us are bored. And I just imagine, what if people, especially those in the church, went from being spectators to witnesses if they would lose their boredom? Because we're going to see that happen in the book of Acts. And their lives were scary and exciting because they were witnesses and not spectators. And so if we are his witnesses, what are we to speak about? What are we to confirm? Well, Luke, in his other letter, as he's wrapping up his gospel, he tells us, and he's recording a conversation with Jesus, and I want to share it with you, the last text. In Luke chapter 24, again, this is after Jesus has risen from the dead. He's with his apostles. And he says, now he said to them, these are my words which I spoke to you while I was with you, that all the things that are written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled. And I just want to pause here and say this. Jesus just said the entire Old Testament is about himself. And so some of us, we need to read the Old Testament through those lenses, that the Old Testament is ultimately to point us to Jesus. This is what Jesus just said. And then in verse 45, it says, then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. He opened the disciples' minds, the apostles' minds, to understand the Old Testament. And he said to them, so it is written that the Christ would suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance for the forgiveness of sins would be proclaimed in his name to all the nations, beginning from Jerusalem, where they are. And notice what verse 48 says. You are witnesses of these things. And so as witnesses of Jesus, what is our testimony? Our testimony, he was dead, and he rose. And for those who, through faith, ask for the forgiveness of their sins, they will find salvation in Christ alone. That is our testimony. As a witness of Jesus Christ, that is the truth we are to confirm. That is our testimony. That is our witness, just as it was the testimony of the original apostles and the early Christians. But notice verse 8, where it all begins. There to be witnesses in where? Where does your Bible say? What does your Bible say? Jerusalem. That's where they were. Jerusalem was their home base. It began in Jerusalem. And if you go on and read the rest of chapter 1, you'll see that after Jesus gave this mission, he ascends to heaven. And these ragtag band of disciples, they go back to Jerusalem, and they go in the upper room, and they're there, and they're waiting like Jesus asked them to wait, and they're praying. And it says there's 120 in the room together. Jesus' mother is there. His brothers are there. And they're all waiting in Jerusalem, their home base. And they're praying. But as we study the book of Acts, and as we go chapter to chapter over the next several months, we will begin to see how they are empowered by the power of the Holy Spirit. And they are emboldened by the promise Jesus gave to them that they would be his witnesses. And they literally change the world. And you know why I think they changed the world? I think they changed the world because they were tethered to the mission of Acts chapter 1, verse 8, that they would be, not might be, they would be his witnesses, beginning in Jerusalem to the ends of the earth. And so what does that mean for us today? What does it mean for us, for you and for me, to be tethered to this mission? Well, for some of us, it means we need to maybe give our time and invest in others. And so as soon as we're done here, you need to go find your place of service so you can start using your time to invest in others. That's what, for some of us, that's the call. To be tethered to the mission of Acts 1:8, it means we must invest our time in serving others. Maybe for some of us to be tethered, it means we need to give up some of our treasure. We need to give up some of our treasure. Now, for some of you, you may be new here, or you may just have been around for a little bit, but you're not familiar that we purchased 4 acres just to the west of us. And our desire is to pay off the debt, $400,000 left. And our church has been amazing to pay this debt off. But we want to pay this off so we can kind of expand our Jerusalem. We want to be able to expand our Jerusalem so we can reach the thousands of young men and women and teenagers and children that are moving into our Jerusalem, Parker County. And so as I've been thinking about this, I thought yesterday, if I'm going to ask some of you to give up some of your treasure, I thought I better be ready to give up some of my treasure. And so at the end of every service, I'm taking some of my treasure, and there's boxes out on the back, and I'm putting some of my treasure in those boxes to help us in a small way, but in a sacrificial way, so we can expand our Jerusalem and to reach the people that God has brought here. And so maybe for some of you, it means to give up some of your treasure. That's what it means to be tethered to the mission. And maybe lastly, it's to be tethered to the mission, it means to use your talents. Just like Luke. Luke was a physician and he leveraged that to care for the needs of others and help advance the gospel. So maybe you're a stay-at-home mom, or maybe you own a business, or maybe you're an educator. What does it look like for you to leverage your talents to advance the gospel of Jesus Christ? It is now our time to be tethered to this mission that says that we will, by the promise of Jesus Christ, be his witnesses in Parker County and beyond. Let's pray. And as we have a time of response, I may ask you first to maybe pray right where you are. And just maybe ask God to reveal to you what it looks like for you to be tethered to the mission this morning. And maybe ask him to give you the courage to take that step. And as you pray, I want to also pray with you as well. So Father, we do thank you for our time together around your scriptures, your very, very words to us. And we pray now, as we've studied the word, we pray that your spirit would work in each and every heart in this room. God, we want to be a people, we want to be a household, we want to be a family of faith that is tethered to the mission of Jesus Christ to be witnesses here and beyond. And so we ask for the empowerment of the Holy Spirit and be emboldened by the promise of Jesus. May we be a people that's tethered to that mission. We pray this in the great name of King Jesus. And everybody said together,